So today, indeed, I want to talk about the benefits of interacting particles. And this is based on joint work with my collaborators Panos Parpas, Nick Gantas, and Greg Pavliotis. So basically, the idea is that typically when we're optimizing some objective function, what we do is we run independent instances of the optimization algorithm. And the question we had is, what if we run multiple copies, so many of those instances, and we let those particles or copies interact? The questions are, do we gain anything in terms of like variance reduction, conversion speed, or robustness? With the underlying intuition being that, well, we're having multiple particles now, and they're kind of exchanging information about where they are in our last function space. So would this give us any benefits? The setting in which we work in this particular case is constraint optimization. So basically, our objective is to minimize some function f of x, where f is the objective function, and we take it to be a strongly or irregularly convex function. And we have a constraint set curly x. So our objective optimization objective is to basically minimize this f of x such that x lies in our constraint set curly x. And we're looking for the minimizer x star. So the optimization algorithm that we use for this is mirror descent, which in general is a generalization of projected gradient descent. So I don't want to go into too much detail on how mirror descent works, but very roughly speaking, basically what it does is we start with some point, let's say x, in our constraint set. And then what we do is, using this mirror map phi, we basically project into our unconstrained set. In this unconstrained set, so this z, we then take a step in the direction of the negative gradient, where the step size is determined by this eta. And then once we have that, we have this zk plus 1, and we project it back into our constraint set through the Bregman divergence that's associated to this mirror map phi. So basically, we find the x in our constraint set curly x such that it's closest to this zk plus 1, where the closeness is measured in this Bregman divergence distance. So the idea is to kind of go from the primal space, so the space in which our x's live, to the dual space, which is this unconstrained space. And if we choose our mirror map in a good way, then basically what happens is that this can achieve a way faster convergence rate than regular projected gradient descent, making mirror descent a more efficient alternative, in particular in high dimensional cases. So when this dimensionality of our problem is relatively large. Okay, so we consider a bit of a different setting even more. We consider stochastic mirror descent. So basically, from the motivation that the gradient estimate can contain some noise. For example, if we compute it over batches, as is done in machine learning algorithms such as batch gradient descent. Or for example, you might want to add noise from different for different purposes, such as purposes of differential privacy, so maintaining the privacy of your system. Under these assumptions, we have the noise in our system. So additionally to this gradient step in our dual space, we also have this additional sigma times a Brownian motion, which adds certain noise to our estimates. And we consider this algorithm to be in continuous time. So this is the algorithm that we will analyze. So basically, this Z is evolving again according to a gradient step with this additional Brownian motion noise. And then X is again the projection of our dual space back into our constraint space using this mirror map phi. So this is the very general setting in which we will be working. And then we have the first result, which is relatively standard for stochastic optimization. It basically says that if we assume that our objective function f is a convex function, then we have the following convergence result. So basically what this result says is that our time average of our f at xt minus our f at the most optimal x star is bounded by this term, which is decreasing in time. So as we increase our optimization algorithm, how much we run it for, it's going to decrease this term. And then initially we have this noise term, which is a function of the amount of noise that we are adding into our system. So it's a function of this sigma squared. So the thing that we see here is essentially that the gap to optimality, so the distance between this f of xt and this fx star, so our optimal x, is bounded above by a quantity that decreases in time, but also a quantity that is proportional to the noise variance. So the more noise variance we have, the further we're going to be in expected value from our most optimal loss function value. So then the question is, if we assume additional interactions, and I will in a moment define how we particularly consider these interactions, if we consider that, can this lead to anything such as some kind of variance reduction? So could we converge closer to the optimum if we let our particles interact? So what we do in this interacting setup is, instead of using independent particles, we consider interacting particles. And specifically what we do is we run n of these copies of the optimization algorithm, so these ZTIs with I ranging from 1 to n. Each of those I's evolves again according to this negative direction of the gradient. And then we additionally have this interaction term, where this theta defines the interaction strength, so how much value are we putting on the particles interacting with each other. Then we have this Aij, with A being the interaction matrix, and it basically tells us if two values are exchanging, or if two particles, sorry, are exchanging their values or not. And then we have this ZTJ minus ZTI term, which basically tries to enforce consensus or some kind of agreeance between the particles. And of course, our noise term, which we also had in the independent setup of the optimization algorithm. So the idea is that if we let these particles interact, so if we have this additional interaction term where the strength of the interaction is controlled by theta, can we gain something? So then we look at the convergence result that we get if we consider this interacting stochastic mirror descent algorithm again for a convex objective. So in this case, let's define a fluctuation term, which is going to tell us how far each particle, so each ZTI, is from the system average, so the average over all of our particles ZTI. And then basically we get the following results. So again, this time distance between our FXTI and our FX star, so the most optimal one, is bounded from above by this term that is decreasing in time. So we have this 1 over 2t times a constant term. Then we have again our noise term. However, now what we note is that our noise term is additionally decreased by a factor of n. And then we have these two other terms, which are basically related to this fluctuation term. So this guy over here. So we have these expected values of the two fluctuation terms. In first case, just over ZTI. And in the second case, summed and averaged over all of the ZTIs in our system. So what does this say? Well, the first term that we saw, so this 1 over 2t times this d, which is related to our Bregman divergence and our Merriam-Webb phi. This is the standard optimization error that we always get. So we also got it in the independent setup. And this is decreasing, again, linearly in time. Then the second term that we have is the sigma squared divided by 2n times, again, this bound on the Merriam-Webb phi. And what we note here is the interesting thing. Basically, the variance is decreased by a factor of n, where n is the total amount of particles that we are considering. So basically, having more particles in our system and letting them interact, if we can bound these two guys, so these two terms which are related to our distance from the particle average, if these are sufficiently bounded, then basically increasing the number of particles that we let interact can lead to a variance reduction effect. So this sigma term is decreased by a factor of n. So then the question is, as I said, if those fluctuation terms, those tilde ZTIs, can be bounded, and if they are non-increasing with n, then indeed we have succeeded. We have reduced our variance by introducing interacting terms. And the good news is that luckily, under certain assumptions, indeed we can bound this fluctuation term. And in particular, what we obtain for this fluctuation term is that this average over the fluctuations over all of our particles, it can be bounded by an exponentially decreasing term, the first one, and then the second term, which is basically non-increasing in n, but it decreases with this interaction strength times the type of interaction that we have in our system. So for a sufficiently large interaction strength, for a sufficiently strongly convex function f, and for a sufficiently connected system, basically we would get indeed a variance reduction effect, because in this case the fluctuation term would be bounded. So what are then, to conclude, those benefits of this interacting stochastic mirror descent as opposed to regular stochastic mirror descent where the particles are behaving totally independent from each other? Well, if we have a sufficiently large number of particles n, and if the function is sufficiently strongly convex, if the interaction strength is I enough, so this theta that governs how much value put on consensus between the terms, if that is high enough, And if the interaction between the particles is dense enough, and with this I mean that the interaction graph that determines which particles are exchanging values is sufficiently connected, then the variance is reduced by a factor of the number of particles that we use if we compare this to running just independent particles. So let's look at two examples in which we investigate these variance reduction effects in practical settings. So if we consider a linear system where basically the goal is to find this minimum of this L2 loss of AX minus B, with X being in a constrained set where curly X is the simplex. And then what we do is we consider the setting that is standard in machine learning, the optimization objective. We basically compute the gradient over a subset of the data. So in each iteration, we take different data samples, and over these we compute the gradients. So in this case, the gradient obviously contains noise, and we want to see how can interaction basically decrease the effects of this noise in the gradients. And particularly, we want to compare kind of the cost of interaction, so the cost of having more particles interact, to the cost of having an increased batch size. So this is one of the results that we get. So basically here we have several optimization runs. So the first one, the blue line, basically uses a batch size of 10. So we compute our gradients over 10 data samples in every iteration. And we only consider one particle. So capital N, which is the number of particles, is 1. Then we have the orange line where we consider, again, 10, the batch size of 10, but we consider 10 particles. Then we have the green line where we consider a batch size of 100, so a much larger batch size, but still one particle. And then the red line, which is a full batch, so we compute it over all of our data that we have, and we again only use one particle. So what we see from this comparison is basically that our interacting particles, so the one where we use 10 particles and a batch size of 10, it kind of leads to the same convergence speed as would the red line, which is the full batch gradient descent. So essentially with this, what I want to say is that using more particles, so letting more particles interact, it comes at an increased computational cost, obviously, because we have to run more particles. But this computational cost is kind of comparable to increasing the batch size by a similar order. So basically, if we increase the batch size by an order of 10, so having like 100 instead of 10, or increasing the particle, the number of particles that we have, it kind of gives us the same convergence speed. And then a bit more interesting example, namely non-convex optimization. So this example is kind of different from the variance reduction, but in this particular case, we wanted to see what else does interaction give us? Does it give us anything else besides variance reduction? And in particular, in deep learning, you might have heard of this thing that flat minima generalize better. So basically converging to a minimum which is more flat in your weight space can also lead to a better model that's going to perform better on your tests. Data. So our question was, can interaction help in any way? Can it help converge to like these more flat minima? Can it help to converge to more robust minima? So we tried this out with this Müller-Brown potential function, which is an objective function which contains several saddle points, several local minima, and each of those local minima have different flatness in the weight space. Basically what we see here is that if we start from some saddle point and we use 10 interacting particles and we either let them interact or we don't let them interact. So this particular picture on the left is where we don't let them interact, and this guy is when we do let them interact, so the picture on the right. What we see here is that when we don't let them interact, basically each of those particles is going to converge to some of the local minima in our system. Obviously, like depending on where they started from, they're going to converge to some of the local minima close to them. However, if we impose a sufficiently high interaction strength, then what we obtain is that actually all of the particles are going to converge to the same minimum, which obviously makes sense because we are imposing this kind of consensus that the particles should be agreeing on their value. But the interesting thing is also that this particular minimum to which they converge, so this one around 0.0 and 0.5, is also the minimum with the lowest Hessian in our parameter space. So what we could see as the most flat minimum. So the question that we haven't necessarily proved in theory, but at least see in some of these practical examples, is that in a non-convex optimization objective, which you obviously have if you're considering something like deep learning, interactions could also help you converge to a more robust, aka a more flat minimum. So to conclude, basically what we did is we wanted to see if it's if there's any point in considering interactions between particles. So instead of just running IID particles, we want to see what happens if we also impose this additional consensus term, so an additional interaction term between the particles. And the question was, well, if we let these particles exchange information in this way, is there any benefits that we could obtain in terms of like the performance of the algorithm? And in a convex setting, we can prove indeed that there is this variance reduction effect. So if our interaction is sufficiently strong, and if we impose a sufficient, if we use a sufficiently large number of particles, then indeed the variance of our algorithm can be reduced, and we're going to be converging closer to the optimum. And also, at least numerically, in a non-convex setting, we saw that maybe interaction can also lead to convergence to flatter minima, which could be an interesting thing to study in terms of like the non-convex optimization. And before I finish, I want to mention one more thing, is that this obviously has similarities with distributed optimization, where in distributed optimization, every particle is kind of optimizing their own local objective function. And in this case, we assume that they're all optimizing the same objective function. So that's the difference. But very clearly, they have similarities between the two. And that's it. This is all I wanted to say.
Well, thank you, Anastasia. Jemima, do we have questions?
Yes, we do. We have one question from Nancy Nichols, which says, in the last example, what happens in the noisy situation?
Well, that's a very good question. Basically, if we have a noisy situation, we have to consider the interaction strength to be even higher, because additionally, we have to mitigate also for the noise that the different particles are observing. So you could obtain kind of a similar convergence as this guy, but you would have to pay more attention to how you're defining the interaction if you're using a sufficiently strong interaction strength.
Great, thank you.
Okay, I guess on Zoom there are no other questions. Minhong, on YouTube, do you have any question?
No.
Okay. In that case, I would say thank you, Anastasia, and we'll go to our next talk. Just to one remark for our audience on YouTube, we're sorry there was a technical issue in starting the streaming on time, so probably the beginning of the talk was not didn't start on time, so the full talk will be available on YouTube after the seminar. Thank you.